This episode is brought to you by the Fempower Health Perimenopause and Menopause Channel. If you're not subscribed and want to learn more about perimenopause and menopause, make sure to subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts. You can search for Fempower Health Perimenopause Menopause Channel or click the link in the show notes. And if you're interested in chronic pelvic pain, we also have a dedicated channel for that. Search for Fempower Health Chronic Pelvic Pain Channel to explore more.
In the realm of breast cancer prevention with chemo prevention and medications, that's another one of these areas, which is who owns that? How does the patient have access to a discussion about that? It's really not the OBGYNs are not really comfortable doing chemo prevention. The patients aren't in the medical oncologist yet. The primary care don't really feel comfortable doing this anyway. And again, it's a lack of training and education. And it's like hot potato again. Who really owns this part? And the time when it should be happening, again, is in this 40 to 60-year-old woman, where the impact that we can have on that woman is huge. And we're not doing a great job.
Welcome to Fempower Health. This is Georgie. In today's episode, we dive deep into the truth about menopause with the incredible Dr. Lisa Larkin, a trailblazing women's health internist with over 35 years of experience. Menopause is a hot topic, but it's also a confusing one with myths, misinformation, and a healthcare system that hasn't kept up. Dr. Larkin shares her evidence-based insights on navigating menopause, addressing the care gaps, and making informed decisions about hormone therapy, supplements, and more. Whether you're in the thick of menopause or simply curious, this is a conversation you don't want to miss. Take a listen. Dr. Larkin, welcome to the Fempower Health Podcast. I am so honored to have you here because you are so incredibly data-driven in everything that you do, and you really stick to your guns around it. In our little brief call chat before this recording began, and also in our previous conversations. And so it is a true honor to have you here. Thank because you. Menopause is hot right now. Before we dive into the whole conversation, why don't you tell us about yourself and your mission, and then we can dive into this very important conversation.
Well, great. Sure. Well, first, thank you so much for having me. It's really an honor to be here to talk. So I'm a women's health internist, and I am an old internist, even though menopause is really having a moment now. I've been practicing in the menopause space for almost 35 years now. And I tell the story, or I say that, because I think it's important to give perspective in that, you know, I use the journey of menopausal hormone therapy. I would tell you that it has defined my entire professional career. And really what it shows is that data evolves over time, science evolves over time, because in the course of my 35 years of doing menopause and women's health practicing, you know, we've gone all over the map when it comes to hormones. And I think, you know, we'll talk a little bit about kind of where we are today, but we've gone from 10 years I was practicing before the Women's Health Initiative data came out, and then 22 years since the data has come back out, and where we've morphed in terms of our understanding about menopause, all of the implications of menopause, and how to manage menopause has changed dramatically over those 35 years. And I think I have a really interesting lens, perspective, practicing, taking care of women all during this period of time. So I'm still a practicing internist in Cincinnati, Ohio. I have a private practice that now has 3 office locations and 11 other, or a group of 12 clinicians. I have a women's health company called Ms. Medicine, which is building a network of women's health focused clinicians practicing in clinics and office bricks and mortar. It's not a telemedicine women's health company. And then I am just launching a women's health nonprofit as well, focused on evidence-based women's health education. And that's me in a nutshell now, an old 61-year-old still practicing women's health, internal medicine, and menopause.
Awesome. Well, thank you. And you do not look 61.
Yeah, I'll add to that. I'm a breast cancer survivor of 10 years myself too. So have that all. I often, when I'm talking to women, you know, really my own personal perspective about being both a menopausal woman, a breast cancer survivor, you know, I have all of the symptoms of my patients. And that brings, I think, a perspective to my care now as well, in addition to kind of the whole 35 years of the journey of menopausal hormone therapy.
Yep. No, and I'm so sorry for your struggle. I actually have a friend who got diagnosed with triple negative BRCA. Thank goodness it was caught early. And thank goodness she is in the pharmaceutical industry, actually works in oncology. So she is as equipped as one can be. So for her 18-month journey, so to getting better. So I'm happy that you,
thank you,
survived your journey. Good. Yes. Thanks. So, menopause. So first I want to set context, because what's interesting is, I've been talking a lot about how I really want women's health to go from an echo chamber to an ecosystem. And what I mean by the echo chamber is there's those of us who are talking about this every single day and really see the ins and outs and the challenges that are ahead. It's so interesting. I just gave a talk at the local JCC, and, you know, just the lack of knowledge of the things that are happening and why women are struggling. Like, women are still struggling to find a menopause doctor that can help them. And they refuse to prescribe hormone therapy even. So what I thought would be helpful is, let's set the stage for those who are in that position of like, oh my goodness, wait, what? Why am I struggling? So I would say what I'm seeing, and I would love your perspective, is one, we're kind of in this position of the Women's Health Initiative study has now been reanalyzed, and there was a devastating impact for the past 20 years because of how it was analyzed. But then an added layer is adding in technology. And so we have all these women's health startup companies, and because 50% of the population will reach menopause and we tend to be higher income earners, it is ripe for dollars to be made. So we're at this influx of, holy cow, the data saying menopause is important and there's things to do. And holy cow, these women have money to spend. Oh my goodness, we have technology. So it's kind of this wild, wild world right now. So I would love, from a clinician's perspective, and the view you have, like, let's talk about this first.
Yeah, and then I have lots to say on this topic. And first of all, it really is very exciting. And I think the vast majority of what's happening in the women's health space is really, really incredibly positive. But there are barriers, as you've alluded to midlife women getting high quality care still, that really fundamentally has not changed in the last 30 years of practice. And in fact, in some ways has gotten worse. And let me tell you what I mean by that. Well, first of all, the WHI data that came out in 2002 had an impact that we knew. And I remember where I was the day that it came out, and I was already very involved in the Menopause Society at that point. We knew, those of us working in the space, that the data was being presented in a way that was creating mass hysteria. And we knew from the day it came out that it wasn't being presented in a way that was reflective of really what the data suggested and what we believed women needed to hear. But the consequences were huge and sweeping and have persisted today. And what I mean by that is, like, from that day, physicians became afraid of hormones, had a big X against them. And women became afraid of hormones. And it went from really the vast majority of my patients, again, I was taking care of women for a decade before the data came out. The vast majority of my patients were on menopausal hormone therapy, and then they all went to zero. And even though I understood, even from the beginning, the nuances in the data and was still prescribing hormones, all of my colleagues in Cincinnati, including OBGYNs, largely stopped. And then, of course, we know that the label changed. It has this terrible, you know, class boxed warning on all estrogen containing products. But the other big impact was suddenly everyone was afraid of hormones, and we stopped training doctors, clinicians, nurse practitioners, medical students. Curriculum went away on hormones. And so imagine that now we have 24 years of training physicians who have entered into the workforce. All of the doctors, right, I'm on the tail end of this now, who were comfortable prescribing hormone therapy for some period of time have long since retired. We now have 24 years of training clinicians who have entered the workforce with no understanding of hormone therapy at all, and who really, in a busy internal medicine primary care practice, and in really what's bread and butter of OBGYN, menopause falls to the bottom. Like nobody's really all that interested in it. It's like a hot potato. Who owns menopause? Nobody really wants to own it. And certainly busy internal medicine doctors, you know, my colleagues, they're taking care of sick patients with congestive heart failure and COPD and atrial fibrillation and stroke and dementia. And like menopause, they're not trained, and doctors like to do what they know really well, and they don't understand the data. So no one talked about it. So you don't even ask patients questions. At the same time, women became very fearful. They didn't know where to turn. There was this void. And so for 24 years, we've really harmed women by this lack of messaging of accurate information. Those of us working in the menopause space at the time, we tried to get information out there. But remember, this is long before social media, right? We did not have a great platform. Our organization, formerly the North American Menopause Society, now the Menopause Society, was small. We didn't have a lot of money to do mailers and TV campaigns and big messaging, right? And at the same time that the WHI data came out, also the interest in funding for companies and for research also dried up. So we didn't have the platform to get accurate messaging out there to women. And so despite working very hard, all of us in the organization for decades, we didn't have the same impact that now in the last several years, thank goodness, because of the interest of social media, you know, or the growth of social media, we really now have a much more efficient, effective way of getting information out there to women. And thanks largely to some incredibly articulate, smart, bright, hardworking, entrepreneurial, younger clinicians who have really taken this on. You know, there's a lot of really interest and a lot of messaging out there on social media, which is really helping drive the conversation. Yep. Add to that, celebrities aging, and, you know, just the interest has really grown. The last thing I will say, the other huge barrier, and I talk about this as an internist, where just in terms of how we've harmed women in this space, is the way we provide care to women. There are gaps in care. It's back to who owns women's health. Nobody really owns women's health. Women's health is across the entire lifespan. So trying to say that OBGYNs really own women's health, well, that's not really right. Like, I'm an internist. I take care of women as they age. I have women's health. There's all kinds of consequences of the sex differences between men and women in terms of how we men and women age differently. But midlife, I want you to think about that. So when women are done having children, from that age of like 40 to 60, what's happening with women? Their kids are older, they're done reproductive, you know, their reproductive time, so they're not seeing their OBGYN as much anymore. Who, you know, OBGYNs and reproductive age women do a great job of being primary care providers. But now women aren't having babies, they don't really need to see their OBGYN very much. They get their annual pap smear, they're having their mammogram, but they're not really sick. They're busy with their careers, they're busy with their families. There's very few points of contact with healthcare. So, you know, they're not seeing their internist very much either, maybe for a sinus infection or a UTI. And even when they are seeing their internist, their internist isn't asking them about perimenopause or menopause symptoms. And so it's really this gap. And so I would argue that the time that I as an internist, have the most ability to impact a woman's health as she ages is between 40 and 60. You know, when I'm taking care of, and I have lots of them, my 85 and my 90-year-old patients now, my impact on what they're going to die of and how they're going to live their last several years is very small. I mean, I'm tweaking blood pressure medicines. But if I can take a 45-year-old woman and talk to her and identify her breast cancer risk, her cardiovascular risk, her bone health risk, if I can educate her about nutrition, diet, what's happening with hormonal changes, if I really have that opportunity and educate her and empower her with tools, I can change the trajectory of how she is going to age. And yet we as a society don't support those visits at midlife between 40 and 60, right? We're completely neglecting what should be happening with women. And it's, again, all of these barriers to getting the great menopause, perimenopause, midlife health care that women should be having. And there aren't enough clinicians or opportunities for women to get this care.
It was intriguing, your statement around who really owns menopause and who really owns women's health, because I think about my journey and the doctors I visit. So I do the annual physical with my internist, and then I go to the OBGYN for my pap smear and making sure I get my mammogram. And I feel like between the two, it's covered, but is it that not everyone does those types of visits? Is it that the gap in menopause training, like, is it a complex answer?
Well, so that's really interesting. So I would tell you, good for you for doing both of those exams every year. And good for you. I assume you have very good doctors, right? And are in a model where they have adequate time or resources to actually, and they've had training, right?
Right.
I can tell you the vast majority of women, when you talk to them and they come to see me, so, you know, I have both a primary care practice, but consultative women's health practice.
Yep.
And what they're told when they try to raise symptoms with their PCP about perimenopause or menopause. I mean, I just had a patient come see me who said that her primary care physician told her that they had a hormone-free practice, that they don't talk about hormones, it's hormone-free. So, you know, that's the level of dismissiveness that there continues to be in the patients that, at least that I'm seeing. And I hear from my colleagues as well, right? You are having, I think, a better than most experience from what it sounds like. Although I wonder, and I still would, I really believe that the best care of women should be an integrated care model between OBGYN and primary care, because we need each other. I mean, what OBGYNs do, I don't do, and what I do, they don't do. But at midlife, for us to have a model where we are integrated in the care of a woman across that period of time, and migraines is a very good example. In my experience, right? So many times migraines are frequency and severity increase in the perimenopause transition. And I lecture at physician CME events to OBGYNs specifically around migraine. And I can tell you, they're uncomfortable with the new meds and how to kind of manage, even though they're the ones that are really seeing the patients that are having the most trouble. So there's this care gap in women in the migraine space, again, I would say, because there's just not this good integration of care between OBGYNs and primary care, because many times, and we know this in the migraine space, women suffer for decades with having migraines. They're never even diagnosed as having migraines. They've never been prescribed a migraine-specific therapy. Prevention of migraines has never been discussed. And again, because that's not really in the sweet spot of OBGYNs. And they don't recognize, women don't recognize that they should be seeing their internists and that these are migraines and that there's therapy, right? And that's where, again, I think we could improve care of women across the lifespan if we had a different integrated care model that was supported by payers.
No, I agree. And I will add to that with the integrated care model is even the mental health aspects. But even for me, it's this challenge. So I have a mental health diagnosis, and I realized that perimenopause, things really started to fall apart. Menopause, even more so. I literally could not function. And maybe I did and just didn't feel like it. It doesn't really matter. But here's how we had to do this. I would talk to my psychiatrist, who doesn't prescribe hormone therapy because that's not under her wheelhouse, sure. But my OBGYN does. So I had to like have this conversation of, okay, so dear psychiatrist, I'm going to go to my OBGYN and see if the estrogen patch works. And then I guess we have these meds, and then I increase the dose of the estrogen patch. Meanwhile, the pharmacy is saying, oh, you're on this medication. Do you know that if you're on the patch, they both could not work now? So I'm like, well, who's going to, like, where's the data on now what do I do? Which doctor is going to advocate? Because both of them say they don't do each other's job. Like, and this is just one
aspect. And this goes back to, again, what's happened in healthcare in general, right? Is we have become more and more siloed as specialties, and it really requires, and you are correct. So, and I, it was wrong that I didn't bring up the mental health piece, because that is really, we need the integration of mental health care. And that's happening more and more in primary care, is to have mental health embedded in primary care practices. But you're 100% correct, which is I spend a lot of time with my psychiatry and psychology colleagues making phone calls. And actually I have a core group that I use because, again, to your point, the interplay of mood, just like I use the example of migraines, mood and the perimenopause, menopause transition, we know that that is a huge time for mood instability related to the hormone changes that are happening, and integration of hormones and other psychiatric medications and management of the patient requires multiple specialties. And that model really is broken in our healthcare, current standardized healthcare delivery models. In fact, I just did grand rounds at our academic center here in Cincinnati. My talk was on breast cancer risk assessment and prevention approaches. And even just talking to the residents and the questions that they were asking, they have no integration of this whole idea of risk assessment and who's doing, who in the realm of breast cancer prevention with chemo prevention and medications. That's another one of these areas, which is who owns that? How does the patient have access to a discussion about that? It's really not, the OBGYNs are not really comfortable doing chemo prevention. The patients aren't in the medical oncologist yet. The primary care don't really feel comfortable doing this anyway. And again, it's a lack of training and education. And it's like hot potato again. Who really owns this part? And the time when it should be happening again is in this 40 to 60 year old woman, where the impact that we can have on that woman is huge. And we're not doing a great job.
No. And so now it's really, at this point, it's left to the patient. And you know, this is killing me, because like I'm in a, again, fortunate position, because I'm interviewing all of you and I hear the little bits and pieces. Like, for example, I had frozen shoulder recently, and now we have the musculoskeletal syndrome of menopause being discussed. But do you know what my doctor kept asking me? Sometimes this happens in women because of a thyroid condition. Do you have a thyroid condition? No, I do not have a thyroid condition, but I was in my final stages of perimenopause and it was not on hormone therapy. And you know, was it that, or was it?
Well, again, it goes back to, there's just been, and we all can talk about this, blinders on the fact that hormones may impact these things, and absolutely no research done. I mean, just in even thinking about the impact of hormones on all of what we're seeing. And in fact, we've had blinders on with this. There's been areas, I say the microbiome now that we're learning is clearly another area that we have just had centuries of blinders on about the magnitude of impact on disease that actually has. But you know, when it comes to hormones, if we look at women postpartum after delivery, we see that they have a lot of musculoskeletal injuries when they start, right? And clearly we should have kind of recognized that there is a huge hormonal component to that, because what, of course, going from just before your hormone levels, just before you have a baby to immediately postpartum are very different. And we didn't translate that into looking at any data in the menopause transition about, again, all of these musculoskeletal issues that women start to develop and the fact that hormones do play a role in that. And so again, like the gaps are huge and we do have so much work to do. And we're really, it's an exciting time. And I think the social media and the activism that's really happening now is really going to have huge and I think really incredibly impactful, impact on what's going to happen and change care now.
Before we started recording, we were talking about how so many things are changing so, so fast, right? And rather than, we may still get to it, but rather than diving into what the data says now, I'd almost like to help women figure out, so how do we navigate this for now? Because on the flip side, with this terrible structure that we have in our healthcare system and, the challenges with med school training and things like that, on the flip side, we have so much also being thrown at us. So now we have menopause coaches, hormone clinics, all these discussions around pellets. We have celebrities who are building their own companies. So now we have even more being thrown at us. So I feel like it can be very chaotic. And then let's face it, TikTok is a big place and it's 60, 90 seconds. And a lot of people go there to get their information.
Yeah. It's a little bit of the wild, wild west. And it is really hard to navigate. I mean, I can tell you a real story that happened recently that kind of highlights it, right? Which is women, the goal of the social media and what many of my physician colleagues are doing is incredibly positive. They're really doing a lot of education through books and their own podcasts and their, you know, videos, TikTok videos on social media. And so there's the availability of content and information is out there. But it still becomes confusing.
Yes.
And women are very vulnerable because, as you said, there really is a market. This is really largely an untapped market, right? Because of lots of stigma with becoming older, menopause, right? Like that's had a lot of stigma against it. And frankly, the world didn't recognize the huge business opportunity was there, right? This is a huge market. Now suddenly somebody's realized that there are products, services, things that we can sell to women. And these women are vulnerable because frankly, we in the traditional medical world have harmed women in all those things I just said, right? Like mm-hmm. not being able to educate and train clinicians, not having an ability prior to social media messaging to get the accurate information out there. We've left women kind of hanging to fend for themselves. And so now good news is there's content out there, but now it makes it harder sometimes because it's a mixed bag. You know that there's not regulation of what's said on social media, some things that are very easy to say in single sound bites. And this is one of the things that I've spoken about some is that, you know, sound bite catchphrases in this space, in my opinion, have the potential to also harm women because the discussion has to be much more nuanced. So I can use the example of what we've been doing just with mammography. Let's try to take a simple thing, right?
Yep.
Get your mammogram starting annually at age 40, right? Because we're screening for breast cancer. And that's been the very clear messaging to women. Well, when you look at the data, right? There's lots of people out there saying the data about mammography is bad. The radiation is bad. You know, our guidelines have not been consistent on when you should get them, how frequently you should get them. It's kind of still a mess. How is that after all of these decades of work, is the mammogram messaging still unclear? And I would tell you it's because not all women are the same, right? We are still trying to homogenize information to fit all women. And that fundamentally is not right. Each individual woman has her own individual risk profile, her own individual symptoms, and we need to go back to or continue to really focus on providing individualized care. And in the world right now of social media, I think we have to be careful that we're homogenizing statements again back to saying hormones prevent dementia, right? And again, are we 100% sure that we should be saying that for all women? Because all women have different risk factors for dementia, and maybe the data is not that consistent across all of those subgroups of populations. So the messaging can become confusing for individual patients, and that's where I think we just have to be a little bit cautious out there about what the messaging really is. That's number one. Number two is the void is also being filled by, you know, the need of women for products and services. And because there's no regulation, there can be a lot of stuff being sold and promoted out there that really isn't based in good science. So what's a woman to do? It's really hard. My most recent example is a patient came in to see me who had been to her internist and her cardiologist, had been complaining of terrible menopausal symptoms. Both of them said, you can't take hormones. It's too high risk. Hormones are high risk. You have breast cancer. You've got heart disease. You can't take hormones. She found me. She absolutely was a great candidate for hormone therapy. She was having terrible symptoms. We started on hormone therapy. She messaged me within 4 weeks that it had changed her life, game changing. She then came back to see me 3 months later. She had been back to her internist, back to her cardiologist, and had also listened to a bunch of podcasts and everything on social media, and now was back saying her doctor still said, oh, I don't know if Dr. Larkin's prescribing you hormones, like that's her risk. Like, we don't really believe that. Like, it's okay. Like, but okay, you go ahead and do that. And on flip side, the messaging that she got on social media was that I wasn't giving her an adequate dose and that she needed additional hormones being prescribed as well. And she sat in front of me and she said, this is really hard to navigate. Which is, I've got three doctors that I trust that I've been with a long time. Everyone's telling me something different. And now I'm listening to podcasts and thing on social media and I'm getting something different over here. I'm getting a lot of information and I'm a smart woman. How do I actually navigate this? And I just sat with her and said, it's really hard and I don't know. And I can only tell you that I'm giving you my interpretation of the data and what I believe is best for you. And we can continue to have this discussion being influenced by what you're hearing from your other doctors. But I can only tell you my opinion as you sit here, and it's hard for patients. Yep. And I'm sure you're hearing that among your friends, colleagues, and you're hearing that from some of the other people that you're interviewing, right? Like, this has to be a very individualized discussion with an individual patient, but it's hard for the individual patient
yes.
to navigate it still and sort through all of the information they're getting.
Yep. And I feel like at this stage of life, the shared decision-making is even more critical because of that. So the way I try to look at this is like, what is the goal? And then what do we know versus what do we not know? And that's kind of how, even when I'm managing my own journey, is how I'm trying to look at it, right? So let's talk about some of these products that are being created for women and how can we dissect it. So I'm so nervous to bring this up because I don't want to get in trouble, but look, I'm here to be a straight shooter. I'm not here to, you know, okay. So I was at a conference. I was at the health conference in Vegas, and Halle Berry had just launched her, was talking about the launch of her company. And I think I got an email that she has now officially launched it. And one of the things that she was talking about on stage is this partnership with Joylux, and it's this vaginal thing that you can put in. It's got the red light therapy. And I went online to check the reviews because I like to play devil's advocate on everything before I just get excited. And so the reviews actually seem to be great. But here, before I had read the reviews, I'm listening to her on stage, and she talked about how it's really changed her sex life to use this device. And I was sitting here thinking back to the point of every woman is different. The first question I had to myself was, why did you have this issue? And are you also using vaginal estrogen? Is it actually the vaginal estrogen that helped you, or was it this device? So this was the series of questions I had in my head. And I'm just so curious, like, let's play this out. I see this product, Halle Berry, celebrity, respectable, amazing woman who is clearly trying to do good. Do I buy this $400 device? I mean, how does one make these decisions? Because it says it's backed by OBG. I looked at it. I'm like, it's backed by OBGYNs. There are like 10 doctors on the advisory board. How? Like, please.
So first of all, and you know, this is a hot topic, let's just say. And, you know, I want to be very thoughtful in my statements. I mean, first of all, I believe that Halle Berry and many, many, many of the other celebrities that are working in this space have a large platform and a large voice, and that their mission is to do good in the world.
100%.
I believe everyone that's working in this space is mission driven and is trying to do the right thing for women. I 100% say that with clarity. With that said, you know, again, you started off by saying, you know, I'm an evidence-based clinician, and I try to be, right, data-driven. And, you know, many of the messaging out there right now on social media is about the fact that, you know, we don't have the data because we've harmed women. We don't have the data that women need and deserve, and we haven't done the studies all this time. So we don't have all of the data that we need. And are we going to make women wait for that data before we offer them care? And I would say the answer to that is no, I don't want women to wait. We're doing a terrible job taking care of menopausal women. We don't have enough women who should be on hormones and would get benefit from hormones on hormone therapy. I don't want to withhold care from women. And I'm a huge advocate also of advancing care. But I think where that line is a little different for all of us in terms of how much data do we want to see before we were actually promoting something. And I think that line may be very different for someone like Halle Berry, who's not a scientist or a physician, who doesn't probably really understand, and again, I don't want to badmouth her, and I'm not trying to badmouth her, but she just doesn't have the same science background in understanding what it takes to have clinical validity in terms of data that would make, I might require personally more data to feel comfortable recommending something than Halle Berry might. And it goes from devices to supplements. And where I sit in this for you, if I want to be specific about you, should you spend $400 on this product? Okay. This is where I sit with patients. Okay. So I feel strongly personally that I don't sell supplements or sell things in my office as a revenue stream. That's just me, right? Because those things, it would be like selling prescription drugs, right? Like there's a little bit to me, and not everybody feels this way, and everyone has to make their own decision. There's feels a little bit conflicted, right? In terms of my recommendations may be biased. But the other thing for me, specifically when it comes to supplements and devices, because they are not required to have the same data to be cleared by the FDA, the bar is much lower than with drugs. You know, there's a lot of stuff that's being promoted that frankly doesn't have great data, that some of the watch groups, the consumer product things, you know, have some flags about, right? Because there's just not a lot of data. Where I sit though, for a patient sitting in front of me, so say that you're sitting in front of me as a patient, what I always ask myself is, where are you at in this shared decision-making process? How much data do you really feel you need to have? And the other thing is, do I think that what you're doing is going to potentially cause you harm? And if the answer is no, you are a healthy 52-year-old woman and you want to take all of these supplements and these different things and you want to try all this stuff because you've been reading about them and because there is some data about things that nutrition and diet and things that we can be doing to live healthy, and I don't think it's going to cause you harm, I'm all about that. I am absolutely all about and completely supporting. And for you with these devices, there's not a lot of data. I can tell you in my 35 years of practice, we've seen devices come and go in terms of big hype initially with lots of data, then it kind of falls by the wayside. And I think it's very possible that this may be another one, or it may not. But do I think that if we look at red light therapy and we look at, you know, lots of the other laser devices that have been out there, do I think that there's huge risk in causing you harm? The answer is no, I don't. Okay. And so do I think that in conjunction with vaginal estrogen, it's going to work better? Yes, I do, because I think that the vaginal estrogen is what's largely giving you the benefit. Do I think pelvic floor physical therapy is helpful? I absolutely do. Do I know what incremental benefit you're getting out of the red light portion of that? I don't. Maybe it's helping a little bit. Do I think it's harmful? I don't. And if $400 for you is something that you can afford and it's worth it for you to try the benefit, because you may be spending that much for vaginal estrogen too, I would say you can certainly go ahead and try it. But it's confusing for women. And it's a long answer to say, like, this is a hard area, because we do want innovation in technology, because there are things that, again, we could be doing better for women. And there's not really, unless there's a market opportunity, there's not really companies that are interested in making the upfront investment to develop these things unless they know that there is that market opportunity. So again, I don't want to be so pie in the sky and rigid that I shut off innovation. That's the other thing you hear out there, is that, you know, some of the reluctance I have for those things may harm women, because again, we're trying to shut the door on women. And that's really not true. Where I go again with kind of even just the supplement things is, if I worry it causes harm, right? The big area is, if I have a woman who has a lot of other medical problems, who's on a lot of other medications, these supplements just aren't studied with other drugs, drug-drug interactions, potentially negating the benefit of some of the other drugs. That's where I start to raise a little bit of, like, I'm a little more cautious with that. But in general, you know, I'm really supportive of women wanting to use supplements, try supplements, and some of these devices.
I love your answer. That is such a good answer. So then let's talk about precautions with a few other things that are coming up. And I think your answer is incredibly fair, because, you know, it's, I try to look at data for various things, and it's like almost all the documents say not enough. We need more research. We need, and I'm like, oh my God, this is really hard. And so you just kind of go with what.
Well,
you know,
let me just jump to that, if that's okay. Cause I will say one thing. You may know that on September 30th, the Menopause Society came out with a statement that was out there about concerns about misinformation and disinformation in the space. And, you know, I really support that statement from the Menopause Society. And obviously I'm on the board of the Menopause Society, but that was taken among some of the other clinicians working in the space as, again, really being something that was going to harm women, that we were trying to shut the door again on advancing care of midlife women and recommending hormone therapy. And I really want to say to anyone that felt that way or is listening to this, is that that's not the intent, but I do believe that professional societies, when they have guidelines, it is our obligation as the professional society, as ACOG, the American College of Physicians, the Menopause Society, to really take a hard look at data and to set the bar based on the data that's there at the time. We all know data evolves and guidelines will change and evolve, and they may lag a little bit behind the data, but I think we all should think that we as the societies are trying to do the right thing for women by setting the bar very high, at least setting the goalpost. No question, all of us that are practicing, it's through shared decision-making. And when we're talking to an individual woman in front of us, we may go outside of what those guidelines are through a discussion with a one-on-one patient. But I think it's unfair to bash the Menopause Society for trying to really set the bar with guidelines based on the existing data, because I think that that should be, and I think the consumers, women, should want us to, for those guidelines, have a very high bar, recognizing that there's lots of other stuff going on and opportunities to kind of go off that, but that it's like the gold standard. We should have a gold standard in healthcare, a best practice kind of.
Yes. No, and it makes sense. And I guess, you know, what I could see happening is maybe people read it and view it as black and white when it's a lot more complicated. I mean, I know there's criticisms of some of the ACOG guidelines, like even with endometriosis and things like that. So it's such a complicated answer. Like I was interviewed on a podcast and I felt like they were trying to make me black and white about certain things in healthcare and you know, finger pointing. And I'm like, the answer is it depends, like, on so many things. And I know that people may want me to, you know, have this discussion with you or anyone and say, this is what you do. And it's not that simple. And well, I feel like that's the hardest message.
It reflects our entire society that we sadly are too polarized, and that the nuance and that the gray has been blurred by black and white lines in the sand. And in my opinion, especially when it comes to individual care of all patients, and women we're really talking about today, it's much more nuanced than that. And we lose the high quality care that we really can all provide by taking away the nuance. It's a complicated discussion. Not everybody agrees.
Exactly. Because we know this is a gray area, how can one, as they're going through this journey, assess if it's right for them? So one is hormone clinics, pellets. I see so many different things about pellets and menopause coaches. And by the way, I went online and there are so many coaching certifications. I'm like, I have no idea which of these is good. So I'm a woman and everyone's telling me pellets are the best. Are they the best? Hormone clinics, are they, you know, if I hire a coach, is it a good thing or not? Like, and maybe it's the same answer, which is why I dumped you with all three of them. But I'd love to get your perspective on how can we make sure we're getting the proper care and having that informed decision-making conversation and evaluating these trends that are starting to happen in this space.
Right. I mean, the first and most important thing I would say is all women should realize they have to be their own best advocate. And the first and most important thing is to empower yourself with understanding that you know your own body best. If you're having symptoms, they are real, and you should not let any physician dismiss them, right? So that's the first thing, that you need to be empowered, that you know your body and you take charge of your body, and you need to seek out and get care that is addressing your symptoms. And that can be a multidisciplinary approach like you just talked about getting, right? So you have your OBGYN, your internist, and your mental health professional that are all kind of involved in putting that together for you. So the coaching aspect is relatively new. It definitely is exploding, but I think there's probably a role. I don't know exactly how they all fit in, but again, with, you know, say career coaching or any kind of coaching, I mean, having someone that you can talk to and set a plan and a progress and engage with can be very powerful. And I support women accessing that. Where I would just caution everyone, though, is to remember that the coaches are not physicians, clinicians. And where I think they should be careful and women should be careful is when they are the ones specifically making treatment recommendations, because I think they probably are outside of their scope in that. and you really want to be seeing a nurse practitioner, a physician, a clinician to be talking about your, you know, hormone therapy pro and con, or options for your care and making sure you're getting comprehensive care. Now, here's the thing that I would say, and remember, this is me, and this will be a little bit hot of a topic among your listeners, I'm sure, which is, I really believe that women at midlife need comprehensive longitudinal care. And what do I mean by that? I mean one-off visits or visits that are just deciding whether or not you should go on hormone therapy and giving you a pellet without completely looking at you as a whole person. And I see this in the weight loss space right now too, with medi spas and IV infusion centers giving compounded weight loss medications as well in a vacuum. And I've had 3 patients with complications so far, that's not the best care for women, right? So although certainly I know it's all out there, and I know because of the lack of access that women have often to finding a clinician that actually has any knowledge or training in the menopause space, that they're lost. And so the easy access points are sometimes these medi spas and these hormone centers, because it's easier to get hormones of some variety there. And so I understand why they're growing, but to me, that's not best practice, best care. Because again, I've seen way too often in my community here in Cincinnati where patients have been to the hormone center. They've never had a physical exam. They've never had a comprehensive history done. So all of the family cancer history, breast cancer risk assessment, cardiovascular risk assessment that should be done as we're thinking about considering a patient for hormone therapy, that's kind of neglected. They just kind of check a box. They're having brain fog and hot flashes and vaginal dryness, and they get started on pellets. That to me is not good quality care, but it's certainly happening again because of the void that we've created. And so my bias is for women to find a menopause certified clinician and to build that clinician into their care team with their other established physicians, as opposed to using these hormone centers. But pellets are a whole nother story for me. And that is something that I can speak pretty clearly on, which again, will get some pushback, which is the dosing is just wrong. And patients are not adequately informed about dosing that they're getting and what they're getting. And a quarter of my practice now is getting women off pellets after they've been on them for 2 years and they're starting to have side effects related to the super physiologic dosing. And I just can tell you that we can give bioidentical FDA approved hormone preparations without doing pellets in a much more evidence-based, safe way. And I certainly know the pellet industry is exploding. It's certainly exploding in Cincinnati. So my statement about that is going to be very unpopular, but it really is genuinely what I believe.
Yep. No, I get it. I mean, I think of my fertility journey. It was 4 years and it was constantly unexplained infertility and I was fed up. So what did I do? Anything anyone said. I mean, there was a person who convinced me to spend hundreds of dollars a month on supplements. So I get it.
I get it, because that's right. The void that we have created has created this, right? And so we as clinicians own some responsibility for this. Like there's just, but again, I would like all women to have high quality care and just working on that.
Yep. No, I agree. And, you know, I guess, tell me if this is a good framework is, you know, at the end of the day, you know, in midlife, because of our hormones changing, we have to face the reality that we're going to have symptoms. It doesn't mean we're old. It doesn't mean something's wrong with us. It doesn't mean don't go to the OBGYN or the internist because that means you're old. You simply have hormones changing and you're going to have symptoms and you should have a good quality of life. Hormones therapy is safer than was pitched to us 24 years ago.
Yes.
You still need to have shared decision making, and you also need a full risk assessment as part of that shared decision making.
Yes.
Is that a fair foundation?
Yes, it's absolutely fair. And I think from my standpoint too, right, I think it's a framework shift as well a little bit, right, still, which is we all would like to prevent aging. We all would like that, right? We all would like the fountain of youth. We all would like, you know, but that is just not reality. And so Yes, absolutely. What the messaging should be is symptoms are real. There are huge physiologic consequences of the menopause transition. We all should be doing everything we can to age healthy and well so that we can do the best we can as we get into older age. But it's not a perfect fix. There is no aging, right? And so I think making sure that we remember that, because we're not trying again to do something to find the fountain of youth. We're trying to, again, think very carefully about what the data shows in all aspects, and hormones is only one part of that, about how we should age healthy and well as we transition from midlife and we get older. And there's certainly a million things we all could be doing better, and hormones are really only one piece of that.
Dr. Larkin, thank you so much for your commitment, because I know it's hard to go against the grain, so to speak. It's hard to, you know, have these real conversations. And yes, it would be fun to just have us be silly and, you know, talk about the fun things or whatever. But I just want this to be the facts, because it's really important, and it's clear both of us are dedicated to that. And so I really appreciate you standing up to sometimes the hard stuff.
I'm only one opinion. There's lots of voices. And again, yes. I recognize that my opinion is not the end all be all. And there's lots of healthy debate in the space, which is good.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And that's why I like that you're getting your voice out there, because you're not even trying to say my way is the right way, which is important for people to understand. So thank you so much for your commitment. And that wraps up another insightful session here on the Perimenopause and Menopause channel of the Fempower Health podcast. Before you go, I've got two quick, exciting invitations for you. First, join our vibrant community by subscribing to our newsletter. And it's not just any newsletter. It's your frontline update on groundbreaking women's health research, the latest health-enhancing products, and unique discoveries you won't want to miss. All of this delivered straight to your inbox, cutting through the noise of social media algorithms. Better yet, you can pick the Perimenopause and Menopause edition or the Chronic Pelvic Pain edition or both. Second, if you enjoy our Perimenopause and Menopause content, don't forget that we also have a main Fempower Health podcast feed that covers a wider range of women's health topics. Additionally, if you're interested in chronic pelvic pain, you can subscribe to that specific feed too. Find these channels on our website or wherever you listen to podcasts. And if you love today's insights, show your support by rating and reviewing our podcast. Your feedback is more than just a pat on our backs. It lights the way for others seeking guidance and community in their health journey, amplifying the voices that need to be heard. And for a deep dive into today's topics, check out the show notes and explore our website at fempower-health.com. Our site is a treasure trove of knowledge neatly categorized by topics of interest, ensuring you find exactly what you need to empower your health journey. And your voice matters to us deeply. Whether you have a question, a story to share, or feedback on our episodes, reach out directly at info@fempower-health.com, drop us a message on social media, or hit reply on any newsletter. Your insights inspire our conversations. And don't forget to follow us on social media for more updates, tips, and community interactions. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok at fempowerhealth.perry.meno. Quick note, the knowledge we share here is to embolden you in discussions with your healthcare provider. It's not medical advice. Always consult with your doctor for health decisions. And remember, the diverse perspectives of our guests reflect their individual journeys, and it's not an endorsement by Fempower Health. And here's to empowering your health journey one episode at a time. See you on the next Perimenopause and Menopause episode of the Fempower Health podcast.